जो
हेलो सर. हेलो डॉक्टर संजीव.
Hi,
हाय, हाउ आर यू?
how are you? All well, good, great.
थैंक यू. थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग अस. थैंक
Absolutely, my privilege and pleasure. Yeah.
यू. हाय
डॉक्टर संजीव.
Hi, hi Gagan.
मिस्टर गगन इज हियर. ही इज अ मॉडरेटर टुडे.
Yes.
We will start in 4 minutes, 7:05 we will start. We are waiting for our ICF president and vice president to join us.
Perfect.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
Kala, is this event only for Singapore chapter members or is it for other chapter members
also? Other chapters
also
can join.
Oh, okay. Because you said president, ICA president and
yeah,
everybody is
so
joining.
Yeah, we are doing virtual events and we always open to other chapters as well.
Okay.
That's an advantage of having these online events, right?
Right. That's right, yeah.
They are joining us in a minute, President and Vice President. Once they join, we'll start.
Namaskar, madam. Good afternoon. Good evening.
Good evening, sir. How are you?
Fine. Namaskar, Mahavir bhai. Namaskar.
Thanks for joining us, sir.
Mahavir ji, namaskar. Atul. अच्छा वो उनका audio connect हो रहा है.
Yeah. Right.
Namaskar. We are together.
Oh, okay, okay. That's nice. Nice to see you both together.
Good
evening.
Hi. Sorry, I got some connection problem. So now, all right.
Namaskar, Mahavir bhai.
Sir. Namaskar, Atul ji. कैसे हैं आप?
बस एकदम अच्छे से.
अंबुसारिया जी.
हाँ, दोनों साथ ही हैं जी. साथ में ही. हम साथ साथ हैं.
I have a dear friend.
हाँ, हाँ,
हाँ. He's also a chartered accountant.
Hi.
And, also a company secretary and a PhD in insider trading with I think executive director of the Dalmia Bharat Cement.
Dalmia Bharat Group, yeah, that's right.
And,
that's right.
Very intelligent. I think you need to utilize its services also sometime, Atul ji.
Kind of you, Mahavir, for those kind words. And hi, Atul, how are you?
Yeah, fine, sir.
Great.
You have recognized me.
I do recognize you. We met long back. And you were actively, very active in, I think, Institute of Costs and Works Accountants of India as well.
That was way back, sir. 15, 17, 16 years back.
Yeah. So it's long back.
Yes. But I used to visit your company as well.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. That's right.
With your one of your old
colleagues. Yes. Good to see you. Long time. Yeah.
Sir, can we start the program?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you. Good evening. Greetings from ICA Singapore chapter. Welcome to all our members and members of overseas chapters. Dreams can become a reality when we possess a vision that is characterized by the willingness to work hard, a desire for excellence, and a belief in our right and our responsibility to be equal members of society. Atmanirbhar, a step taken by the Indian government authorities for business opportunities to realize the milestone of being a self-sustaining and a USD 5 trillion economy. To implement this vision and how the CA profession, especially its overseas chapters, could contribute in this endeavor of Government of India, we have today with us Mr. Mahavir Singhvi, Joint Secretary, IFS, to speak on vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat, role of diaspora. It is a great honor for us to have you with us, sir. Congratulations to you on achieving the CA Achiever in Public Service Award recently. Also, thank you to you for giving the recognition to all the overseas chapters of ICAI to be treated at par with other APEX trade and industry organizations for purpose of economic engagement. We are sure this recognition would help us to further enhance our engagement and strengthen our relations with APEX organizations and Indian consulate offices. Joining him in the panel is Dr. Sanjeev Gamawat, Executive Director, Dalmia Bharat Group. It is our pleasure and privilege to have him with us today. Today's session will be moderated by Mr. Gagan Malik, Tax Partner, Ernst & Young. It is also a great pleasure to welcome CA Atul Kumar Gupta, President, ICAI, a man of astute intellect, sharp vision, who is widely respected for his organizational skill and deep insight in the affairs of profession, and who has immensely been contributing to the profession with all the initiatives. Congratulations to you once again, sir, on elected as a board member of International Federation of Accountants, IFAC, at the IFAC Council meeting in November. Next is with us a man of professional wisdom, vision, and with a firm belief in all-round inclusive growth of Indian chartered accountancy profession. A blend of erudition, experience, foresight, technical expertise, and professional excellence worth emulating. It is our great pleasure to welcome CA Nihar Jambusaria, Vice President of ICAI. To start the event, I would like to invite our Vice President, CA Nihar Jambusaria, to share a few words with our members. Over to you, sir.
Kalaji, thank you so much. Honorable President of the Institute, CA Atulji, and as you rightly put, very dynamic leader and a visionary. CA Mahavir Singhvi ji, Dr. Sanjeev ji, who are today's faculty to speak on Atmanirbhar. And let me at the outset thank Singapore chapter for thinking about organizing this event on Atmanirbhar. For many months, we are discussing Atmanirbhar and the efforts of chartered accountants in contributing to the government towards the Atmanirbhar efforts taken by the government. And as chartered accountants, the government, society, and business all are looking upon us to contribute towards rebooting, restructuring, and the Atmanirbhar initiative of the government. So although at various fora we discussed about how to go about it, today, Mahavir Singhvi ji, particularly from IFS, will be able to tell us as to what exactly the government is planning under Atmanirbhar, what exactly it means, although we have got this message from the Prime Minister and the government. In detail, he will explain as to how we as chartered accountants can, again, as partner in nation building, contribute to the initiative of the government. You rightly raised the issue of taking economy to $5 trillion as it was planned before the pandemic. Although there is some break because of the pandemic, we chartered accountants will ensure that we again put the economy in a fast track, or rather help government in putting economy on fast track and achieve the target of $5 trillion as early as possible. So today we will have very rich discussion by the two experts, CA Mahavir Singhvi ji, who apart from his experience will be able to give even government thinking behind the Atmanirbhar initiative, and Dr. Sanjeev, who has also got so many years experience. This talk will add to what we have already discussed and will give a firm direction to our efforts in contributing to the government's efforts. Thank you so much. And I wish that today we have excellent sessions by the two excellent speakers. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. May I now invite our president, Mr. Atul Kumar Gupta.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson, from the Singapore chapter. And also, under her guidance only, that the ICAI opened the second office across the globe after the Dubai in the Singapore for her dynamic leadership. Our own colleague and very respected CA Mahavir Singhvi ji, the IFS, and with the ministry, the joint secretary, and the number of laurels are there with the Mahavir ji. So I used to say that for Mahavir ji, that for the CA profession, we should give a Bharat Ratan to Mahavir bhai, that because of him today, there are number of initiative for the profession. I can tell you that the boost to the entire schema of having the new chapters and the representative office in the country is actually get motivation when under the guidance of the Mahavir bhai, the Ministry of External Affairs
our own secretary MEA announced that all the chapters and the representative office will be recognized, is being recognized by the Ministry of External Affairs with any apex body. And parallelly, they also approved the two other initiatives. One was in relation to the ITEC, that is, the any international regulator coming to India will be trained by the ICAI under the guidance of the MEA. That is again a contribution, a very valuable contribution and recognition to the profession under the guidance of Mahavir Bhai. Our colleagues who are there on this particular program, and from India, I can see Sushil Ji, and from Venkat Ji, from for one of the former chairman of our Singapore chapter, other colleagues, a very good afternoon, good evening, as per your location to all of you. Friends, as being rightly preamble given by the preamble given by Madam and aptly supported by our honorable and the worthy Vice President ICICA Nihar Niranjan Jambusariya Ji, that when we talk about the Atmanirbhar Bharat, so we are aware that the chartered accountants are the very, very important constituent of this entire, I will say, the vision of our country. When we are looking into the profession of the chartered accountancy with the 3-year rigorous training and the most difficult evaluation system in the world, actually, when the chartered accountant, somebody is becoming a chartered accountant, he is actually a business solution provider. And that's why the chartered accountants are being recognized not only in India, but if you will go to anywhere in the world, in more than 100 countries, you will find that the chartered accountant is the only community in the profession of the accountancy which is being recognized with the, I will say, in a best of the possible way by the any of the regulator and even in the companies. Even I can tell you that the chartered accountants, when they are spreading their wings at any part of the world, they are maybe joining at the middle level, at the initial stage, but actually they are gradually reaching to the top leadership position, which is very, very important when we talk about the Atmanirbhar Bharat. The Atmanirbhar Bharat means that we will be having the self-reliant in the supply chain system. And for that, we required a lot of investments flowing to it. There will be some kind of a bilateral relationship, not between the countries, but also between the organizations per se. And there will be a kind of a cooperation and the cohesive working between the two different organizations at the different geographical jurisdiction they are. Now, I can tell you, when somebody is going outside India, other than the chartered accountant, they are not reaching to that decision-making level as compared to the chartered accountants who are becoming the CFOs and the CEOs of the various organizations at the global level. I'm giving an example. When the Vish Arunachalam from USA, San Francisco, told me that the GM Motor CFO is a chartered accountant. Today, the Harvard University Dean, who recently got the highest civilian award from the country, is again a chartered accountant. So our chartered accountants are on the best of the position who can take the decision for the investment in to and from India. They can be the best facilitator of export or the import to and from India. So something, when you are looking for a person who can take the decision and is a part of this fraternity, is certainly a not only a time to cherish, but also a sense of duty, a sense of responsibility is getting shouldered to the profession of chartered accountancy. I believe that under the guidance of the Ministry of External Affairs and specifically our brother, CA Mahavir Bhai, that under his guidance, our chapters who are now today available in the 43 countries of the world, in the 64 cities of the world, will be very, very instrumental in bringing that kind of atmosphere. Last but not the least, when we are looking for the more and more investment coming to the India, when we are looking for a more and more dialogues and the bilateral trade between the two countries and the different part of the world, it is again very important that we have to inculcate the best practices as well. Whether it is a practice to start a company or it is the environment of a better compliances, the easy compliances, meaning thereby the ease of access and ease of doing business. I am happy to intimate you that the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, through its chapter and the representative office, initiated a study on the inculcating the best practices wherever they are in the across the world, and see that how we can do our provide a suggestion to the government of India that yes, these are the best practices. For example, I can give you a small example. When we are looking for formation of Indian our company in India from our overseas location, there is a concept of a resident director. So in India, you are looking for a person who is a 6 months here in India, then can only become a resident director. But in a Singapore, you can always have a resident director, which may be nominated later on after the formation of the company. So this is a small type of, flexibility in the policy, but that can facilitate a lot of companies getting incorporated in India with the ease of operations, which is available to them. So I just wish to share, Mahavir Bhai and all my colleagues here, that these international practices are not only useful for India, but also since our chartered accountants are the important constituent of each of the economy at the global level, these practices can be inculcated at the different countries also once are being researched and prepared by the team of the ICAI. So I believe that with all these ecosystem which is available, the knowledge, the skill set, the rigorous type of a training which is available to the chartered accountant, actually they can be the most important instrument in this Atmanirbhar project or the 5 trillion or a 10 trillion project, whatever we are looking for. I can tell you one more aspect, that where the support from the overseas chapters may be very useful, that gradually we are moving to a situation of a one district, one product concept, meaning thereby we are looking for opening of the small and specialized special economic zone for the various product for one or the other district. For example, the Firozabad is famous for the bangles. So we can always have a specialized special economic zone in the Firozabad to boost the export of the bangles from the Firozabad to the different part of the world. So I wish that gradually there will be more thought process which will come into that direction, and then there will be not only inclusive growth, not only that we will be supporting the MSME through the profession, but also we will be seeing that our colleagues, our companies or our units, our entrepreneurs are becoming the net exporter in the times to come, along with the bringing a lot of investment into India. So I believe that with this discussion, the dialogue, the vision which will be shared by Mahavir Bhai, Mahavir Ji and all our colleagues, will set a direction to the Chartered Accountant Fraternity. The vision the government is looking for, the action point the government is looking for, will be deliberated and shared by the Mahavir Ji and other colleagues, will be useful to set our targets, set the way forward for the profession at large. With this, I congratulate Madam Kala for organizing this kind of a workshop or the talk, and inviting Mahavir Ji and all other colleagues to share their word of wisdom, which will be beneficial for the profession, beneficial for the country, and beneficial for the even to the entire humankind, the society. Thank you very much, Kala Ji, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir. It is our pleasure once again. As you rightly said, we chartered accountants are in a position to make decisions, and we facilitate the investments from and to India. And you also mentioned about the best practices. And we definitely, as we say, that all chartered accountants will be an important instrument in this Atmanirbhar vision, and we'll work towards that. Now, going into the session, I will invite Mr. Gagan Malik to take this and to take it forward. Mr. Gagan.
Thank you, Kala. I hope everyone can hear me loud and clear. Thank you for your kind words, and thank you, Mr. Gupta and Mr. Jambusaria, for your insightful comments and laying down a base for this wonderful session. So I welcome you all today to this session. I'm very sure we would have a lot of insightful comments from Mr. Singhvi on what's going on in India with regards to Atmanirbhar Bharat. Just a couple of quick comments on Atmanirbhar Bharat. This is a term as was coined by PM Shri Narendra Modi ji in about mid-2020. This essentially refers to a self-reliant or self-sufficient India, for making India a bigger and more important part of the global economy, pursuing policies that are efficient, competitive, and resilient. But what's important, and this is something which Mr. Modi, our Honorable Prime Minister, said many times, Atmanirbhar Bharat does not mean being protectionist or isolating from the world. It is being self-sustaining and self-generating. And this is an extremely important point which we, as fellow chartered accountants, should be aware. Foreign direct investment is very welcome, as Mr. Gupta also very clearly mentioned. So it gives me immense pleasure to say further few words about Mr. Singhvi. And sir, I was reading about your qualifications. You are a LLB, you're a CA, CS, CWA, MBA, Masters in Diplomatic Studies in Oxford, BCom Honours. Sir, is there anything left which you are pursuing right now? I thought our members may be very happy to hear about that, because I don't know if there's anything is left here, right? You have some energy. But anyway, to let you all know, Mr. Singhvi has also been bestowed with laurels and accolades, including the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India's Business Leader in Government Department, British Sherning Fellowship to pursue Foreign Service Program at the University of Oxford. And he was one of the only people who got an overall distinction, and which was, you know, commended as rare and laudable by the university in a letter to the government. So, sir, it's amazing to have you. I'm sure looking at your qualifications, your overall impact, all the youngsters who are here today, I'm no more a youngster, but all the youngsters who are here today will be very inspired by you. But before I invite you, may I also take a little minute to even introduce our other guest, Dr. Sanjeev Gemawat. Dr. Gemawat is currently working, as Kala mentioned, as an executive director, legal, and group company secretary with Dalmia Bharat Group. As is evident, even Dr. Gemawat himself is an extremely accomplished and well-learned man, being a CS from India and UK, cost and management accountant, a chartered accountant, and besides being a postgraduate in law, and finally, doctorate in insider trading. I guess he also, you know, was spending all the time studying. Thank you very much, sir, to join us today, right? So with this, I would like to start this session. And Mr. Singhvi, may I invite you to please share your perspective with us on this policy, because it's very important for us to understand where we are headed, what is government thinking, and what you see in it for us. Please, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Gagan. That's a wonderful introduction which you gave. Thank you for that. It is indeed a pleasure to be here today and to speaking to you all on a very important subject, basically, which is about Atmanirbhar Bharat. And particularly, I'll be speaking on the role of diaspora in that, and what is the role of chartered accountants also in that. So our institute's president and vice president have already set out basically the outlines of what is Atmanirbhar Bharat and how to go about it and what is, you know, expected out of the members. But I'll be elaborating in a little more detail about it in my address. You have also mentioned about that this term was coined by the Prime Minister when he announced a kind of economic revival package during the pandemic to bring our economy back on the track, which was hugely disrupted due to the pandemic. In many ways, the theme of today's event, that is the role of diaspora and particularly professionals like you, who are working across the world in industry, consultancies and businesses, highlights the global implications of Atmanirbhar Bharat approach. It also helps create new avenues for stronger connections with you all who are members of our diaspora. Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative, as you all know, emphasizes on a comprehensive civilizational self-renewal. It aims at not only mitigating the economic impact of the pandemic, but instilling confidence in our business and industries, making our domestic manufacturers globally competitive, integrating our domestic agricultures and small farmers with the global food supply chains, opening the market to increased incoming investment and technologies, and build greater national capacities so that we can make a stronger contribution globally. Even otherwise, these are all laudable goals, but the experience of the COVID pandemic has driven home the need for more trusted, resilient, reliable, and redundant supply chains. Involving the diaspora in this endeavor is natural. Our diaspora has always been enthusiastic contributor to the nation building. Secondly, as high achievers in their own societies, members of diaspora, particularly people like you, can bring to bear resources, technologies, best practices, and innovation to the task. Thirdly, you help in giving the ambitious exercise a truly global footprint. I therefore hope that today's event would serve as an inspiration to make this a shared enterprise. Here I would like to clarify, and in fact already been clarified, that the idea of self-reliance or Atmanirbhar Bharat doesn't mean seeking self-centered arrangements or turning the economy inwards. What is aimed at is to achieve is that to ensure India's positioning as the nerve center of the global supply chains. Through building self-sufficiency, we intend to contribute towards mitigating disruptions in the global supply chains by enhancing availability of products that we have the capacity and build capacities where we have the potential to do so. As you are all aware, the initial steps of Atmanirbharta was taken during the course of the pandemic. A forward-looking economic approach was enunciated by the Prime Minister under the rubric of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. The stimulus package of nearly 10% of the GDP, amounting to nearly $270 billion, which is roughly translates to around 20 lakh crores of rupees, launched by the Prime Minister in May 2020 under the Abhiyan, aimed to both reinvigorate the economy and provide a social safety net to our vulnerable sections. Another economic stimulus package, termed Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan 2.0, of rupees 73,000 crore was announced in October 2020. Thereafter, a third package known as Atmanirbhar Abhiyan 3.0, consisting of 2.75 crores, was announced in November 2020. In his address to the nation, the Prime Minister identified five key pillars of our future economic roadmap under the Abhiyan. These are creating a new economy, state-of-the-art infrastructure, technology-based delivery systems, leveraging our youthful demography, and harnessing domestic demand. Achieving rapid growth and development will substantially depend on successfully integrating and assimilating all these factors. Friends, as part of social safety and welfare measures, India launched one of the largest food security programs, which you are all aware of, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana, early in the lockdown. This was primarily to support our vulnerable sections of the society, and it worked well. For rebooting the economy, the Abhiyan aimed at bringing about structural reforms and providing relief measures. Such reforms and relief measures under the Abhiyan covered almost every section of the Indian economy, including small farmers, migrant workers, agriculturers, the MSME sector, small businesses, startups, industrial infrastructure, healthcare, education, among others. As you know, there has been a big push to private sector participation in many areas, including coal, minerals, defense production, civil aviation, power distribution, social infrastructure, space, and atomic energy. New public sector enterprise policy would be a significant step in this direction in enabling private participation in a greater number of sectors. You would have also seen government's plan to invite private players to run trains on certain routes and modernize our railway stations. These are just a few examples of opening previously restricted sector to private participation. The government has also made access to affordable capital easier for smaller business, which are important economic engines and job creators. These reforms aim to level the field for the Indian industry, the growth of which has been hampered by complicated laws and regulations. As you know, MSME, which is the backbone of our industrial economy, have also been provided with a massive economic package under this Abhiyan. This include extension of CRR relief on MSME loans, injection of additional liquidity in the economy to the tune of $18.3 billion, and extension of emergency credit lines to MSME from banks and NBFC up to 20% of the entire outstanding credit. This measure alone will benefit 4.5 million MSMEs. To enhance and strengthen the domestic manufacturing ecosystem, the government has announced a production-linked incentive scheme to boost domestic manufacturing capacities in 13 sectors of the Indian economy. The government is opening previously restricted sectors to private participation and has also made access to affordable capital easier for smaller business, which are important economic engines and job creators, as I said earlier. These are just a snapshot of, the measures which have been announced. If you take them together, they offer a huge opportunity. The government of India is also committed to easing the doing of business ecosystem in India. The government is working on a mission mode on the next phase of ease of doing business reforms relating to easy registrations of property, fast disposal of commercial disputes, and simpler tax regime for making India one of the easiest place to do business. Sustained measures taken by the government of India has resulted in steadily improving India's position in the world of World Bank's doing a business report, which in fact our ranking was 142 in 2014, which has now come to around 63 in 2019. So there has been a quantum jump in that. The Indian manufacturing sectors has also opened up to investment in the form of finance and technology. Given the rebound in domestic demand and the promise it holds, the manufacturing sector of India is expected to fetch high returns in the future. To this end, we look forward to engage more meaningfully with our diaspora on the issue area, seek their recommendations and suggestions for providing a further boost to our initiative, as well as invite them to actively participate in the Indian economy as responsible stakeholders. Friends, Atmanirbhar Bharat also provides a vision of India's plan to become a $5 trillion economy by promoting Make in India, Make for the World, as has already been spoken by the president of the institute. In this endeavor, India would be dependent on attracting investment from its partners across the world. The thrust will be on joint ventures in infrastructure and manufacturing, integrating into supply chains and tapping sovereign wealth funds. India is one of the most liberal FDI regimes in the world. There has been 13% increase in the FDI inflow into India in the last 5 months. Our estimates suggest that India attracted more than $22 billion FDI during the pandemic. And most of these investment came in through automatic route. I must emphasize here that we will be happy to work with potential investors from across the world, including through our National Investment Facilitation Agency, Invest India, which has recently won UNCTAD, the prestigious United Nations Investment Promotion Award for the year 2020. Some of the sunrise sectors identified by Government of India and which should also be looked at by investors include food products, high efficiency solar, photovoltaic cells, electronic and technology products, auto components, pharmaceuticals, telecom and networking products, specialty steels, white goods and advanced chemicals, cell battery, etc. Friends, as I said earlier, the COVID-19 pandemic has emerged as an unprecedented threat to the economic foundation of the nations across the globe. It has exposed vulnerabilities in the global supply chains. It has made countries reassess their vulnerabilities, especially in the healthcare infrastructure, availability and affordability of life-saving medicines, as well as in the critical healthcare products. India stands ready to collaborate with the world in addressing these vulnerabilities. As you know, even during the pandemic, India worked to boost its pharmaceutical production, especially of hydroxychloroquine and paracetamol. In order to respond to the growing global demand, we supplied medicines to about 150 countries. Our medical teams were deployed to neighboring countries who were in distress. Because of our proactive assistance to the countries in need, India has come to be seen as pharmacy of the world. Further, as the largest vaccine producing country of the world, our Prime Minister has assured the global community that India's vaccine production and delivery capacity will be used to help all humanity in fighting this crisis. I would be happy to let you know that from January 2021 onwards, we have gifted close to 50 lakh doses of vaccines to our neighboring countries based on requests from these countries. Commercial exports of vaccine have also taken place to Brazil and Morocco. Gifts and exports of vaccine to some more countries are in the pipeline. I believe that all this will also open up opportunities for various sectors, including MSMEs, especially for those who are engaged in the healthcare sector. Friends, the Ministry of External Affairs has been working to promote India's image as itself a safe and reliable destination where all investment-related requirements can be facilitated for the manufacturing units planning to shift their base to India. Our missions and posts abroad are in the forefront of these efforts. Our missions are identifying exports and investment opportunities for our business in various countries and are working closely with industry associations. In addition, we are constantly engaged with global corporations looking to diversify manufacturing locations. The idea is to provide such industries with a compatible business environment to leverage India's domestic demand and bring investment and, of course, jobs into our country. Our mission will be happy to work with you in facilitating trade and investment flows in India. In fact, a preliminary assessment was done by our mission, which indicated that in the short term, we can expand our presence in the global value chain in sectors where we have been traditionally strong. We can leverage existing capacities in sectors such as textile and apparels, gems and jewelry, chemicals, etc., by scaling up production to cater to a wider demand both globally and locally. In the medium and long term, we need to move up to the value chain in sectors such as electronics, pharma, engineering, design outsourcing, etc., where we are present but have the potential to do more. Eventually, we need to target high value added incentives while continuing to build our lead position in basic manufacturing. We also need to work on development of technology and intellectual property across industries. Friends, the inputs from our missions also indicated that our record of managing the pandemic of this scale with decisive and early steps and a low per capita incidence and death rate has drawn favorable international attention to our resolve and capabilities. These are critical elements in helping brand India's disaster management and regional and global first responder capabilities. India has also acted as the pharmacy of the world and healthcare suppliers to all parts of the globe. India has the ability to be a bridge between the developed world and facilitating a two-way flow of information, products, and expertise. There is a growing interest also we have seen in yoga and Ayurveda. Our mission have also, indicated that there is a significant market for food, agriculture products, and food processing industries. Indian automobiles, particularly low-cost automobiles, including two- and three-wheelers, will have an augmented market in developing countries. Textiles, garments, and consumer durable industries will have export opportunities as many markets look to diversify their sources of supply. Our missions have also indicated that Indian e-commerce, IT, and IT-enabled service industries have demonstrated that they can work through a crisis of this magnitude. They are obviously the business of the future. Digital highways can be used to leverage our higher education capabilities through tele-education onto a much larger market. So there are many opportunities over there. What I think an area which would be of special relevance to the members of ICI and which we also see as an important factor in economic growth is fintech. It can be transformative for financial inclusion, promoting growth and opening access for poor and rural communities through lowered costs. There was an increase of around 40% in the funding received by Indian fintech companies in the first quarter of 2020. We intend to build on our domestic success in fintech and utilize our capabilities in replicating our digital platform and e-governance initiatives in partner countries under our development partnership framework on a commercial basis. We are also working with several countries on making our digital payment system into interoperable. Our payment systems, such as RuPay card, have already been launched in Singapore, Bhutan, UAE, and Bahrain. The Prime Minister has earlier launched a global digital platform, EPIX, to connect fintech companies and financial institutions. You all being finance professionals could help in these endeavors. Friends, I think ICI chapters and other such associations which are abroad could play an important part in our economic diplomacy and outreach. They are important stakeholders in policy making. They also contribute substantially to showcasing and promoting our economic potentials abroad. In the current context, Indian industry need to come up with business models that are easily adaptable and ensure that economic growth adopts a quick upward trajectory. You being an expert in such matter could help our industry in this. Our assessment is that India will remain one of the fastest growing economies in the post-COVID-19 scenario. And today you might have seen the IMF forecast of projecting a growth of more than 11.5% for India. And the economic growth will gain momentum in the medium to long term. That is our expectation. In this context, I think some of the initiatives which have been taken are quite noteworthy. Particularly the connectivity initiatives in the neighborhood under our lines of credit can act as a force multiplier to accelerate economic growth and development, promote people-to-people contact, and encourage trade and commerce. Our companies should participate in project finance under the Indian Development Assistance. We will welcome such participation from companies. These projects help successfully showcase India's expertise and would assist in turn Indian industry. The second initiative, I think, is about securing migrants which are going abroad. In fact, the pandemic has highlighted the fragility they endure and global shortage of trained personnel in various sectors, especially healthcare and digital. India has the edge in these areas. We are working with partners to ease mobility and build secure environment through bilateral migration and mobility partnership and social security agreements. Further integration of migration platforms with other countries could facilitate orderly migration of workers. We are also helping in promoting and leveraging skills. We are sharing details of skill sets of Indian expatriates returning under the Vande Bharat mission with the Ministry of Skill Development and state governments to facilitate the rehabilitation of the returning workers, seek employment in public and private sector, and even explore re-migration to new destinations. Another initiative which we are looking at is 3T, trade, tourism, and technology. This includes efforts to diversify our supply chains, promote foreign investment flows, and boost Indian export. Growth in tourism in current scenario may take some time, but there are opportunities for promotion of virtual, medical, and Ayush tourism. Identification and promotion of frontline technologies linking our startup with foreign markets, their registration on foreign stock exchange, et cetera, will be important enablers of innovation and economic growth. Again, you, especially professionals like you, are well placed to support the government in all these initiatives. Friends, the pandemic has confirmed the need for a higher level of domestic manufacture, especially in strategic and basic needs areas. We thus have to strengthen our healthcare infrastructure and systems in India. This will include training of professionals, ramping of pharma capacities, promoting R&D, and becoming a big global leader. Similarly, we have to proactively develop export market for agriculture products, develop supply and cold chain, and become a global player in food security. Similarly, global energy partnerships, especially in renewable energy, clean tech, energy efficiencies, and petroleum and natural gas will play an important role in economic recovery. Initiatives like International Solar Alliance and execution of solar energy product and projects in other countries under the line of credits of $1.6 billion can enhance India's international presence in new and renewable energy sector. India has the potential to emerge as the preferred destination for higher learnings also. As I said earlier, we feel that the members of ICAI and are key players in business and industry in various countries and can help drive our economic engagement with countries where they are working. We have asked our heads of missions and post abroad to closely associate ICAI chapters in their outreach to business, industry, and professional organizations and overseas Indian community. We have also, as was pointed out by the President, Institute has given a recognition that the associations and the chapters of the Institute abroad would be treated at par with other industry organizations. We would expect that on your part, you would actively engage in promoting the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat and its associated initiative in coordination with Indian mission and post abroad. With that, I must thank you once again for inviting me. My very best wishes to all members of the Singapore chapter of ICAI, especially Kala Krishnamurthy, who actually requested me to be here on this occasion. Thank you very much once again. Stay safe and healthy. Jai Hind. And maybe now I can request Dr. Sanjeev Gemaw to share his thoughts.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Singhvi. Thank you so very much for your, I was saying you have a large scale of education qualifications, but I think your insights into Atmanirbhar India or Bharat was so much more. It's amazing to hear. You covered every aspect, every industry with such eloquence. Thank you so very much. And yes, maybe, Dr. Sanjeev, maybe I can ask you to share some of your comments, and then maybe I can jump and share some perspective from my side. Please, over to you, sir.
Perfect. First, I would like to thank Mr. Mahavir Singh for inviting me here. And of course, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India's Singapore chapter. Absolute privilege to be here. An absolute pleasure to be here. First, I echo the same and similar sentiments as Mr. Singhvi has expressed. And in fact, you rightly pointed out, Mr. Malik, that he has touched in almost all areas. And so there's nothing left right now in terms of touching those areas. But then still having said so, I would say that, of course, you did mention that what, this Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan is concerned and this, this self-reliance movement or the self-reliant movement, this is not a Swadeshi movement, I would say. It's Atmanirbharta does not mean necessarily Swadeshi. So this is what the context, I think, you tried to establish in your opening remarks. I would say the president and the vice president, both of them have also expressed a similar kind of thoughts, including the thoughts as far as the role and relevance of chartered accountants are concerned. So my initial thought, as far as the whole mechanism of Atmanirbhar Bharat is concerned, of course, not a new concept. Even Gandhiji gave this concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat when he talked about the self-reliance. But then Atmanirbhar Bharat in a new form and shape, today when the Prime Minister announced this Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan as a special comprehensive package, particularly in the context of COVID, I think that has set a completely new standards in terms of our vision and in terms of our thoughts. As Mr. Singhvi rightly pointed out, there are five pillars of this Atmanirbhar Bharat, and those five pillars gives us and provides us a way how we want to progress in the times to come. And these five pillars are, the five pillars are economy, infrastructure, the systems, the vibrant demography, and the demand. Now, these are the five pillars. On the basis of these five pillars, we will have to develop our economic growth. Now, what and how to develop this economic growth is that, yes, there are five phases of Atmanirbhar Bharat also. Apart from the five pillars, there are five phases of Atmanirbhar Bharat. And those five phases of Atmanirbhar Bharat are that, yes, there should be a huge focus as far as our MSME sector is concerned. There's a second is that, yes, and of course, why these concepts have got developed because of perhaps COVID situation, the difficulty which we have faced in the whole process. The second aspect is the poor and the migrant and the farmers. There needs to be a focus on this sector. The third phase is that we need to focus more in terms of agriculture, and the example is the farming laws are an example in terms of creating that focus and changing the legislative framework. The fourth phase is there should be a new horizons of growth. And the fifth is there should be government reforms and enablers. Now, these are the five phases of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Of course, these are not phases in terms of one or the other. They will have to go simultaneously. Now, in this backdrop, we need to understand that what would be the relevance as far as this Atmanirbhar Bharat and the objective which we have set for ourselves. The objective which we have set for ourselves is a $5 trillion economy. Of course, we can always discuss and deliberate whether that would happen in 2024 or 2025. That may be a couple of years here and there, doesn't matter much. But the fact is, we would definitely reach to this $5 trillion economy undoubtedly. Now, but then for $5 trillion economy to achieve, we will have to take multiple measures. And multiple measures include these five phases which we are talking about. Now, I think Mr. Singhvi also mentioned, and you also mentioned MSME sector. Now, MSME sector, which is the base as far as the Indian economy is concerned, an MSME sector which contributes nearly 60% of the GDP, and a sector which gives employment to over 12.5 crores people. Now, this sector, which is already under debt today, with around 60 to 70% debt, under which this MSME sector is today suffering, I think there is a need in terms of developing this sector, because this Atmanirbharta cannot happen in isolation. This Atmanirbharta will have to go along with taking all these people together. But then there are multiple positives in the whole context. One is that, yes, we have a demography which is nearly 60 crore young people we have. We have a huge, huge global services sector, which is nearly 55% of the overall market share. We have a third largest startup ecosystem. Now, these are the positives which we are having as far as the economy is concerned. Now, in this context, we need to understand that whether we can achieve this or not. The difficulty is, and because I need to highlight some difficulties, particularly in view of the fact that ultimately this objective can only be achieved through the participation of the private sector. The participation of the private sector is so key as far as the whole mechanism is concerned, that because the private sector would be generating those kind of revenue, this private sector would be generating those kind of employment or the investment. Now, this private sector needs to be respected. Prime Minister Modi was very clear, in 2019, speech, when he gave that speech on 15th August 2019, when he said that the wealth creators should be respected. I think that is what the culture we need to develop to achieve this Atmanirbharta or the self-reliant movement. And so together with this Atmanirbhar Abhiyan, my brief comment would be that there should be an Urchan Mukt Bharat also. This movement of Urchan Mukt Bharat would be the only mechanism in terms of achieving those objectives which we have set for ourselves. And very briefly, I think our time is limited. I think it's 5:30. So I would be very briefly commenting right now on that. When PM said that the private sector should be respected, it essentially means that the mechanism or the institutions today we have in the system, I think there are gaps. There are gaps, perhaps because of the socialist mindset or otherwise. I think that needs to be addressed. Two more things which I would like to mention here, that we have achieved significantly well as far as ease of doing business is concerned in terms of the World Bank ranking. But then, as regards the enforcement of contract is concerned, we are still much behind. We are at around 163. I think that is a serious concern in terms of achieving these objectives, and that we need to address. And this can only be addressed when we have a systematic change in terms of our bureaucratic system and the justice delivery system. I think these two things which we have to address in the times to come, because unless we have the enforcement of contract in India, in terms of ranking and in terms of actual outcome, I don't think that we would be achieving significantly in terms of the objectives. One more thing I just wanted to mention is that today is the time. Today is the time when we say that we would be achieving Atmanirbhar Bharat. Can we achieve this objective through isolation from the rest of the world? Answer is no. Only two things can help us in terms of achieving this. One is the capital which we need, and the capital can only come through the foreign direct investment. And the second is the technology which can only come through the foreign companies or the foreign technocrats. So to attract this, all the more reasons in terms of respecting more and more respect as far as enforcement of contract is concerned. The future is the fourth industrial revolution. And the fourth industrial revolution is based on largely the digitization. Mr. Singhvi has also mentioned about the digital economy and all that. I think that this is what the fourth industrial revolution has already started. And we as professionals, we need to adapt ourselves. The system needs to adapt itself. The institutions need to adapt themselves in terms of creating that requisite infrastructure and achieving the objectives which we have set for ourselves. Lastly, I would say that Mr. Singhvi and me, we both are members of almost all institutes, but then it's always privilege to participate at the forum where the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India is inviting. We have a special affection as far as this profession is concerned, for the simple reason that the respect which this profession commands, I don't think that any other profession can command. So all the credit to this profession. Wish all of us, wish you all the best, and also a great profession in the times to follow. I think the whether that is the fourth industrial revolution or in terms of contribution from the FDI or otherwise, I think chartered accountants can play a significantly greater role. Particularly, I would say the chartered accountants who are based in Singapore, because I am in the legal profession as well, I can say with some confidence and conviction that all our disputes are ultimately getting referred to the Singapore institutions. So you people can significantly contribute in terms of number of ways also. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev. I think that was such a passionate speech. And I would say that you really have a lot of energy in terms of thought process, in terms of your vision, in terms of what needs to be rectified, the government needs to look at. And I sincerely appreciate it. So with that, what I will do, and this is something I have been listening to Mr. Singhvi and Mr. Gemawat and Mr. Atul and Jambusaria ji. And I think I have just created or summarized it within few comments, and I would want to share with all of you who are here today. So if you look at it, I think Atmanirbhar Bharat, if we put an umbrella over it, essentially there are three aspects which most of us talked about today. And the three aspects, one is the FDI, foreign direct investment. Atmanirbhar Bharat, if you want that, you need FDI, you need foreign investors, you need people to work with you. When you look at FDI, when I started my career almost 26 years back, in India, in the 90s, we had only 36 industries which were allowed for receiving investment, and all others were banned. But over the years today, there are very few industries, I can count it on my hands, which are restricted or there are some conditions attached to it. Otherwise, as Mr. Singhvi also mentioned, today we have 100% foreign investment under automatic route, and that is absolutely phenomenal what Indian government has done. And kudos to this government, which over the years have been liberalizing continuously on inviting foreign investment. So that is the first bucket. The second bucket, I would say, is tax. As we talked about, Indian government has been moving away from profit-linked incentives and has moved towards investment-linked incentives, and which is where it brings us back to the fact that the Indian government also wants that we bring in capital and they will give us incentives. Our clients bring in capital and they will give us incentives. And exactly on the same lines, for the first time ever, India introduced a 17% tax on manufacturing. So if you set up a new company in India for manufacturing, which is Make in India, as was coined earlier, and now Atma Bharat India, right, Bharat, it is on manufacturing, just a 17% tax rate. Again, a fantastic effort by the government. So the first bucket was FDI, the second is tax, and the third one which we have been talking a lot about, is make in India or manufacturing. And this is where I would like to spend a couple of minutes more, as Mr. Singhvi also mentioned about the scheme. If you look at the PLI scheme introduced by the government is actually production-linked incentives. So if you invest in India in those sectors for manufacturing, there are significant incentives which the central government is giving you, right? In addition, they have just come up with another scheme called PMI, which is preference for make in India. So if you want to work with any of the government organizations, right? If you have, or under the PMI scheme, there are regulations, how much value addition you are doing in India. Again, our clients or foreign investors, and we as chartered accountants assisting them, can help them understand that is so much to offer in India by the government. And I would like to take an example, and maybe some of you would have heard during my past speeches, but this is very important. For the past 7 years, I have been working extensively in the region where I'm helping clients move to India in terms of manufacturing. And the key reason here is, what does Indian government do? The Indian government has been so good in this aspect, is that for one of the companies I'm helping, who's moving their manufacturing to India, they're investing, say, $100 million, and the Indian government is giving them back $155 million under various incentives. State government is giving them 100% incentive. Central government is giving them 25% incentives under the MCIP scheme, and then 30% capital subsidy. So what the key point here, what I want to raise, is that Indian government really wants to realize the dream of make in India. States, various states, whether you look at Karnataka, whether you look at Andhra, whether you look at Maharashtra, whether you look at Tamil Nadu, whether you look at Haryana, all of them are inviting investments. And central government is really facilitating the same by adding more schemes like PLI, adding more industries to this, and really realizing the dream of make in India at Atmanirbhar Bharat. So with that, I think I will take a pause. And I think, you know, it has been an absolutely fantastic, insightful discussions we have received. And I would request Kala, if you would want to, you know, say a few words and close the session, and we can take questions if there are any.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Mahavir Singhviji. In spite of your busy schedule, you accepted to today to speak on Atmanirbhar Bharat. And thank you, Dr. Sanjeev, to join us today. And both of you, as Gagan said, Gagan summarized nicely in three buckets and the speech today. Thanks to all of you. So would you like to take questions, Mr. Mahavir or Dr. Sanjeev? Hello, I think you are muted.
We have already exceeded the limit. I have got another meeting.
Okay, fine. So that's fine.
Can excuse me, maybe Sandeep can take some questions.
Okay. That's fine. It's okay. Okay, then it's okay. Thanks to you. And now may I invite our Vice Chairman, Mr. Sanjay, to deliver the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Can I ask one question?
So I think,
may I ask one question?
I think, sorry, Himanshu, I think they have to leave now. So they said, in the interest of time, maybe we can contact them later. So sorry.
No problem. Thank you.
Maybe Sanjeev can answer that question.
Sanjeev? Dr. Sanjeev?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, Himanshu.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sanjeevji and Mahavirji. And absolutely wonderful to hear your speech and the fervor with which you delivered. Sir, I have a similar question on the fifth pillar. We are extremely proud of India's contribution, and we have been and will always be ready with tan, man, and dhan to do whatever it takes to do for India. Sir, just like we have made Covishield vaccine for COVID-19, sir, corruption ka bhi koi vaccine banna dijiye na, sir.
I think, you know, if you notice, I did mention this. I said that the Atmanirbhar Bharat cannot happen without Archan Mukt Bharat, because Archan Mukt Bharat is what is required. Today, I did mention that where we are failing in terms of enforcement of contract, we are still 163rd. So that itself demonstrates that how the system is functioning, the regulatory system or the institutions which we have and the justice delivery system, both of them are failing. I think that we need to do something about it. Now, if you notice that these systems need to be further strengthened. Now, 5 pillars of Atmanirbhar Bharat, one of the pillars is also system. Now, that system, this needs to be strengthened. Now, how to do this? There are multiple ways of doing this. And for that, perhaps a different session or seminar would be required. But that, because it's largely a mindset change. I would just very briefly mention on this that us, 7 decades of bureaucracy, the experience of 7 decades of bureaucracy is largely arising out of socialist thought. Now, the socialist thought mandates and dictates that profit making itself is bad. The moment you have that thought in mind, that profit making is bad, then the government functionary or regulators would be functioning in that fashion. Now, they need to understand that profit making itself is not bad. Profit making is required for further economic growth. And that is what the Prime Minister Modi said when on 15th of August, he said that please respect these wealth creators. That is what the message which he has given. But then this needs to be percolated down in the entire bureaucracy and also the justice delivery system, where we have, and I can say with that responsibility, that we have miserably failed and we need to do something about it. Thanks.
Thank you.
I would just quickly add to it. My blood group is B positive. I'm always very positive about things. So I think I would just say to Himanshu, if you look at what has been happening in the past few years, and specifically with what the government has done in terms of faceless assessments, faceless penalties, and audits, there is a tiny step which has been taken. And I think the government has recognized, and as Dr. Sanjeev said, that there are things in the system which needs to be changed. But what I would say is that there is a very, very positive directional change which has happened. I think I could have never imagined that India will move to faceless assessment, whereby nobody knows who's doing for what. And that changes. It's a game changer in one of the aspects. So to that extent, things will change. We just need to have faith and it will happen. Just a small quick comment. Sorry, over to you, Kala.
Only add a small point here. I completely echo the same sentiments as Gagan has expressed. And we have all witnessed this in the last 10, 15 years, the kind of technology which has been used in various taxation department or the Ministry of Corporate Affairs or various other departments. The technology has been a big game changer. And that is the reason why I mentioned in my earlier part that the fourth industrial revolution mandates not only the way in which we conduct our business and way in which we behave, but then that would also be reflecting and that would also be getting into the government system and bureaucracy. And perhaps that would be a big change also. Anyway, thank you very much. Thanks.
Thanks.
Over to Sanjay.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dr. Sanjeev. Go ahead. Well explained. Thank you. You said that the system and the mindset and with the technology development, we see more and more, as you said, faceless. All this assessment has definitely helped. We have started to make a move and definitely we see the positive change. And over to you, Sanjay. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Kala. On behalf of ICI Singapore chapter, we would like to place on record our heartfelt thanks to CA Mahavir Singhvi ji and Dr. Sanjeev Gemawat ji for making it convenient to grace this occasion by delivering his truly face-setting and very keenly perspective keynotes on Atmanirbhar Bharat, that is Self-Reliance India. CA Mahavir ji and Dr. Sanjeev Gemawat ji, your illuminating account on the Indian and international experience clearly bears out the agenda of Atmanirbhar Bharat will have to be driven in a mission mode by private-public partnership with significant improvement in the economy, infrastructure, efficient technology-driven system, vibrant demography, and extensively leveraging of the demand and supply chain. Wisdom and knowledge shared by both of you on this topic will motivate and encourage our audience to take a lead in the development of India. So thank you very much, sir, for your all knowledge and the share with us. We also like to thank our dynamic president, CA Atul Kumar Gupta ji, and vice president, CA Nihar Jambusaria ji, for your inspirational and motivational speech. And we assure that with the guidance of ICI leadership team, we will make sure that the brand ICI will achieve more glory and success, and together will help to achieve the goal of Atmanirbhar Bharat. We would also like to thank our moderator of the session, Mr. Gagan Malik, for doing a wonderful job to engage speaker and bring a good discussion to the webinar. Your example on various incentives provided by the government definitely will encourage our fellow chartered members, chartered accountant members over here to promote the Atmanirbhar Bharat within their region and with the companies across wherever they are working. Engaging and energetic, to describe Mr. Malik in two words. Also thank to our chairperson, CA Kala Krishnamurthy, for ideation of this event, and CA Nishant Surana, Swati and Mohan BPO team for support and the assistance. Finally, a big round of applause to all our members and the audience, containing members with diverse background, experience, industry domain expert, for attending today's event. ICI Singapore chapter is thankful for your all continuous support and encouragement. Thank you very much, sir, for all your presence and all. Over to you, Kala.
Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you all once again, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Singhwi. Thank you, Mr. Gemma. Thanks, everyone.
Our members. Our next event is on February 9th, the budget event. So see you all. Thank you.